All right, guys, we are week four of our series called Free Indeed. And this is a series that I've been loving it. The last 3 weeks, I feel like we've been really going deep and really tackling some really tough issues. But I believe they're important issues to lead you towards freedom. And we based this entire series off of a life group curriculum we do called Freedom Here. Because I knew that if this was going to be the year of growth, then we need freedom in our life so we can grow and be free to be everything God has created us to be. And so every week we've really been building on every week prior to, and they're like foundational pieces. And so that's why I've been encouraging people not to miss. But if you say, Pastor Micah, I'm new or maybe I missed a week, don't worry, we got you covered. You can go on iTunes, you can go on Stitcher, and you can even go on our website, bloomhere.org, and find all the messages in this series up today. So don't worry, we got you covered. But today we're gonna tackle something called your spiritual order. And you hear that, and you got to understand something. Many times we don't live in freedom because the order of our spiritual lives is all out of whack. And we've got the wrong things in the wrong place. And it's when we get the spiritual order right, we start walking into what God has called us to walk in. And so if you've got your notes, pull them out. But we're going to look at 1 Thessalonians 5:23. And it says, now may the God of peace make you holy in every way. And may your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless until the Lord Jesus Christ comes again. And so there's three things that is recognized here that he talks about. And what this is saying is that we are made up of something called triune beings. You hear that and you go, what you calling me? Try who? Try what? Try me, right? Come on. Triune actually means you're made up of three parts. That we are people, not just a body, but we have three parts that make us up. Watch my great drawing skills. Woo, 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 woo. I, a smug. All right. This is you. And we're made up of three parts. I kind of kept it kind of neutral, so it can be anybody. And the first thing you got to understand is we are made up of something called a, write this in your notes, a soul. We have a soul. And our soul is a beautiful thing. It's how we experience the beauty in the world. It's how we interact in relationships. But our soul reflects our emotions, mindsets, and choices. That we have emotions that drive us. We have mindsets, whether they're healthy or non-healthy. And we have choices. And this is the beautiful thing about God. That he didn't make us like robots. He could have made us any way we want to think and feel any way he desired because he's God. But God gave us the greatest ability ever, and that's the ability to choose. I think it's the greatest gift God ever gave us as people. And you hear that and you go, well, what about Jesus and grace? And trust me, we only get to heaven because of Jesus's grace and love and forgiveness. But the ability to choose that grace, not be forced into it, is what makes the loving relationship real, because love is chosen, not forced. And we have a choice whether or not we want to serve God. We have a choice whether or not our emotions want to be directed towards God. And we have a choice to have a life-giving mindset or a life-taking mindset. Listen to what it says in Joshua. It says, so fear the Lord and serve him wholeheartedly. Put away forever the idols of your ancestors worshiped. Serve the Lord alone. But if you refuse to serve the Lord, then choose today whom you will serve. Would you prefer the gods of your ancestors? But as for me and my family, we will serve the Lord. Joshua's saying there's a choice. You could choose to serve the gods of this world. You could choose to live your life, drive with that mindset and those emotions and those choices, or you could choose to wholeheartedly serve God, but the choice is yours. The second part that we talk about is this. It's called the body. Write that in your notes. Your body is your fleshly desires. It's what we crave. It's everything from the fact that we need to eat, we need to drink, we need to sleep, we need to breathe. But it's everything also into things like our sexual desires, it's our cravings, whether that be greed or lust or power or recognition. It's these cravings in our lives. And so we're made up of good appetites, the hunger for the things of God, or bad appetites, the hunger for the things of this world. And the thing about our fleshly desires is they always try to push us towards compromise. And they have this understanding, they go, how far can I sin and still be in the good graces of God? Like, what's a real bad sin? And what's just a, okay sin? Like, it's a white sin. And so it's this pushing towards this compromise, and it's a trickery. Because what it's trying to say is that you can make little compromises in your life, but what reality is it's trying to push you into a mindset that's gonna take you farther from God. Listen to what it says in James 1:14. It says, temptation comes from where? Our own desires, which entice us and drag us away. These desires give birth to sinful actions, and when sin is allowed to grow, it gives birth to death. And here's the kicker about this, is that it never ever can fulfill itself. It can never end its cravings. It always wants more. It's this cycle of never being enough. And it's only until the Holy Spirit gets involved do you actually start departing from that cycle, which makes up our last part. Write this in your notes. And this is the Spirit. This is our spirit. And this is where God puts himself in us. This is where God puts himself in us. That this is something that you need to understand. We don't live temporary lives. We live eternal lives. And God puts a piece of himself in us. He puts a piece of heaven inside of us. And this is what separates us from every other creation. Other creations, they have bodies and they have souls. How many people have pets? How many people have dogs or cats, right? How many people know those dogs and cats have emotions? They have attitudes, right? Like, I have a dog. Me and my wife got a dog. His name's Toby, our first year of marriage. We've had him for 13 years now. And that dog is spoiled, and he knows he's my baby, and that's kind of the way it is. Well, when he was about 5 years old, my wife said, you know what? I'm gonna bring another dog into the house. He wasn't having it. Didn't want nothing to do with it. He was mad at us. And one night, I go to get in bed, and next thing I realize, he peed in my bed. For 5 years, the dog never peed in our house, but as soon as we brought somebody, he peed in my bed. And his thoughts were going, I'm gonna teach you. Then I yelled his name, and he goes, oops, I shouldn't have done that. And he went, right? Toby! But it's these emotions. But what separates us from everything else is we have a spirit. It's a part of God inside of us. And when Jesus forgives you and Jesus restores you, something happens in the life of a believer. Watch what it says here in 1 Corinthians 6:17. But the person who is joined to the Lord, watch this, is one spirit with him. So not only do we get the benefit of going to heaven because we follow Jesus, but we are joined with something called the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit lives in you. And if you can direct your life to stay in tune to the Holy Spirit, he will give you courage. He'll give you peace. He'll give you strength. He'll give you wisdom and guidance. The Bible says the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead now lives and breathes in you, which means there's resurrection spirit in your life, which means there's no addiction that can hold you down. There is no sickness that can destroy you. There is nothing that's said about you can keep you there, because the resurrection Spirit lives inside of you, and it will resurrect those addictions and restore them and redeem them. It will resurrect that sickness because it even beat death, and it will resurrect who you were and make you exactly who you were created to be. And it's only when you align yourself with the Spirit. And that's where it's at. And unfortunately, there's a battle going on the inside, and there's a wrestling match, and all three of these want to be in charge. Your spirit, which is supposed to be your command center, which God created to be in charge, wants to be in charge. But your body ain't having it. And your soul ain't having it. Your emotions ain't having it. And there's a wrestling match going on inside saying, I want to be in charge. And the thing about your soul and the thing about your body is it has no care for the well-being of the other two. And it's only when the Spirit's in charge do you thrive. But when your emotions and your mindsets are in charge, they will disregard the other two. When you have struggling with negative mindsets or negative emotions like bitterness and depression and anxiety and struggles, you don't want to walk out of that and walk into the freedom God has for you because you enjoy something called pity. And you definitely don't care about your body. This is why people will cut themselves when they're in a bad emotional state. Or they will take on substance abuse to try to mask things in their life, even though it harms their body. Because your emotions, when it's in charge, doesn't care about the other two. And the same thing is true for your fleshly desires. When your body is craving things that are not of God, it doesn't care if it dishonors God. It wants its cravings fulfilled. And this is also why people have low self-esteem and they self-deprecate about themselves based on body images. Because your body doesn't care about your emotions and how you feel. And it is only when the Spirit's in control that these two actually line into what God called them to be, where you have the mindsets and emotions of God and you have the desires that crave the things of the Spirit, but only when the Spirit's in charge. And the reason why we struggle is because we have the wrong order in our life. But we're not the only person that's ever struggled with that. Paul struggled with it also. Listen to what Paul says. And I know that nothing good lives in me. That is my sinful nature. I want to do what is right, but I can't. I want to do what is good, but I don't. I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway. How many people feel like that, right? Wave that hanky, man. It's right. It's true. Like, amen. Like, we do. We're like, I want to do right, but I don't. And Paul hits the nail on the head. He says something. He goes, nothing good lives in me. He says, on the inside, this thing's out of order. On the inside, I'm messed up. On the inside, I've got the wrong place, things in charge. And this is what you've got to understand. Write this in your notes. I can't get my external life in order because my internal life is out of order. I don't know why I'm struggling. I don't know why I keep feeling depressed. I don't know why I'm not happy. I don't know why I feel anxiety. I don't know why my marriage is falling apart. I don't know why I can't ever succeed in work, why my finances are wrecked, why all my relationships are strained. I don't know. Why doesn't God help me? God wants to help you. God desires to help you, but we're allowing the wrong order in our life and it's depicting where we're going. You've got the wrong things controlling the ship in your life. And you've got to understand something, that you can't allow that to happen. Watch what Paul goes on to say. He says, oh, what a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? What a miserable person I am. Why do I keep looking at that screen? Why do I keep saying those things out of emotions? Why do I keep spending money when I can't even pay my bills? Why do I keep overeating? Why do I keep finding myself in compromising situations with my boyfriend or girlfriend? Why do I keep going those places with my friends? What do I do? How do I stop it? Well, Paul has the answer. Paul says, thank God, exclamation point, the answer is in Jesus Christ the Lord. We hear this and we go, well, shouldn't it be something real practical? Like I need to just lose my friends. Or I need to find a financial advisor, or I need to get into marriage counseling, or I need a new place of work. And all of those things are great, and they are very healthy, but there'll never be anything in your life unless you get more Jesus in your life first, because they're gonna be Band-Aids, because you're gonna fall suit to some other problem. You first have to get more Jesus in you. You first gotta get the Spirit in charge so then when you make practical decisions, you make life-giving decisions that are led and directed by the Holy Spirit, not your conscious, rational mind. And you gotta get more Jesus in you. And so to do that, we gotta really wrestle with some tough questions. Because you've got to answer the question of who is in control. You got to answer that. Who is in control of your life? Does your emotions control your life? Does your mindsets control your life? Does your fleshly desires control your life? Or does the Spirit? And the first question you need to ask yourself is this. Are my choices leading me towards compromise? Are my choices leading me to a compromised state? Am I willing to straddle the fence? Am I willing to see how far I can stretch myself over to the other side? Am I willing to get really close to the fire? Paul says it best like this. He says, you say I'm allowed to do anything, but not everything is good for you. And even though I'm not allowed to do anything, I must not become a slave to everything or anything. You need to understand something. You have free will. Remember that free will God gave you? You have the ability to choose anything you want, but not every choice is a good choice for your life. I tell my kids this all the time. I tell them, I say, you can make any choice you want in life, but the choices you make, there's a consequence attached to them. They're either bad consequences and there are good consequences based on the choices. And that carries with us the rest of our life. We either make good choices or we make bad choices. We have good consequences or bad consequences. You tell me, Pastor Mike, I wanna get in shape. I'm tired of being this way. I wanna be healthy. But then you say, you know what? It's more convenient go buy Wendy's and get a cheeseburger. Well, you gonna have a burger belly if you keep eating cheeseburgers every day, right? And that's your prerogative. You know, you wanna do that. That's your own priorities. That's your deal. But you can't say I want six pack abs and keep chowing on cheeseburgers because it's easier to go there than go shopping and cook for yourself. It's a consequence to the choice. You can't be saying, well, Pastor Mike, I want to get a promotion at work and I want to move on up and I want to get a raise, but then you find yourself sleeping in and showing up late at work and procrastinating and finding yourself on Facebook more than you are at the work computer doing work because you're probably not going to get that promotion. You may end up losing your job. It's the choices you make. You can't say, well, I'm tired of my finances controlling me and I'm tired of being broke and I want to get a budget in order. And then you find yourself at Target all the time, strolling next to that sale item. Be like, that's a good deal. My wife does this. My wife will come home and she'll be like, you'll be so proud of me. She'll be like, I got such a good deal. I saved you money. Save me money. You still buy something. Saving me money was not spending it, right? Like, come on. There's the doilies everywhere. I don't even know where we put them all. I don't know what they are. They're like, my wife's like, I do not own a doily. They're all doilies to me. I don't know what they are. Right? We keep making those choices. And that's the same thing in our spiritual life. It's a practical life. You keep finding yourself in those environments. You keep clicking on those links. You keep having those conversations. You keep partaking in those choices. And you're going to follow those consequences that are attached to them. You gotta understand this, write this in your notes. Don't settle for temporary cravings that can never sustain you. Here's what you gotta understand. Those choices, they only satisfy you for a moment. And here's the kicker. The next time, they need a little bit more to satisfy themselves. And then you give them a little bit more, and then they need a little bit more. And then you give them a little bit more, and then they need a little bit more. And next thing you know, your entire life is driven by those choices and those cravings, and you become a slave to them. And they literally control your life. You don't control them, they control you. You gotta ask yourself, are my choices leading to compromise? Number two, is my life reflecting God? Is my life reflecting God? Am I reflecting the nature of Jesus to the world around me? Or am I reflecting a hypocrite to the world around me? Ooh, did he really say that? That's a pretty intense. It ain't nobody's business how I live my life. Get that plank out your eye, right? Like, judge not lest ye be judged. You judge me, I will cut you. The Bible says you're not allowed to judge people. Actually, that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says you're not allowed to judge people. But it actually is pretty clear that people will judge us. And it says that the Bible says that people will identify us as followers of Jesus by the way we live. Listen to what it says in Matthew, very words of Jesus. You are a light to the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for what? All to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. Your life reflects to everyone. Listen to what Paul says. For we are taking pains to do what is right, not only in the eyes of the Lord, but also in the eyes of the man. We're gonna take pains. Do you know it's not always convenient to be moral in a society that doesn't believe in morality? You know, it's not always convenient to follow the Bible when the world tells you it's outdated and not true and stuffy. You know that there's growing pains to growth in your life. But doing the right thing is always the right thing, even if it's not convenient. And God is calling us to take pains to be the reflection of a God of love. And this is what you need to understand. Write this in your notes. The world should see our lives and desire what we have in Jesus. The world should see our lives and go, I need that. They should see our lives and say, despite the circumstances I know they're in, they are filled with love and joy and peace. How do they do that? That when we walk in a room, the atmosphere should shift because the Holy Spirit is literally guiding you and talking through you, and the glory of God is felt. This world needs to have hope in it. We need to show love where people feel no love. We need to show joy when people are filled with depression. We need to show peace whenever people have anxiety. We need to show people that they can be redeemed and they can have purpose. We need to quit being incognito Christians. The world doesn't need ninja Christians that are hiding in the shadows, but they need the light of the world that extinguishes the shadows, because this world doesn't need no more hate, and it needs to have a message that people can be changed and they can be redeemed and they can be restored. And unity can only come when every knee will bow and every tongue will confess under the name of Jesus. Amen? Amen. You should get excited about that. God's calling us to something more. And the third question you need to ask yourself is this: am I treating my body as a temple? Do you know that comes from the scriptures, right? You hear it at the gym, like, my body's a temple, right? Fabio, right? You know, my body's the temple. That actually comes from the Bible. Watch what it says here. Don't you realize that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, who lives in you and was given to you by God? You do not belong to yourself, for God bought you with a high price. That's forgiveness. That's redemption. So you must honor God with your body. See, we got this thing mixed up. Buildings are not holy. Buildings are not sacred. This room is just a room with chairs in it. It's not holy. It used to be a Branson show, so we know it's not holy. We just trying to redeem it. I love Branson shows. I'm just joking. They're like, I'm leaving. But it's not holy. Here's what we do. We look at sacred rooms or sacred buildings, and here's what we do. We walk in, and we're all quiet, right? We take our hats off, right? We're in this reverent state. Better not be drinking no coffee in there. That taints it, right? And it's all this stoic feelings. Yet our own bodies, we don't treat with that much respect. Our own selves, we don't hold that much reverence to. We'll literally watch things that corrupt us. We'll listen to things that destroy us. We'll literally expose our bodies sexually and to cravings that are not of God and not of the Bible. And we'll put ourselves in places and consume things that are not healthy. And we'll disregard the very thing that was meant to be holy and meant to be pure. We let our fleshly desires be in charge. Listen to what Paul says. Don't you realize that your bodies are actually parts of Christ? Should a man take his body, which is part of Christ, and join it to a prostitute? Never. Should you mistreat the very thing that God calls holy, the thing that God redeemed, the thing that God restored? Should you let your cravings run the course in your life? Goes on to say, Paul and Timothy says this: for physical training is of some value. It's good to be in shape. But godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. That only when this is number one, that we actually see our bodies become what it should be and see our mindsets and emotions reflect the very nature of the promises of God. Only when this is number one. When we put our spirit first, it becomes number one. How many people remember the game when you were a kid called King of the Mountain, right? You'd be on a bed and you'd push kids off, right? And the last one standing would win. Well, who would always win? The biggest and the strongest kid, right? Never like the little pipsqueak would win, right? It was always the big one. It was always the one that had the most. That's the same thing in your life. The biggest and strongest in your life is who's going to win the spiritual order battle in your life. It's going to be the King of the Mountain. If you are always feeding your emotions and your negative mindsets, and you keep making compromising choices, guess who's gonna be the king of the mountain in your life? If you're always craving to your fleshly desires, lust and greed and selfishness and hate and bitterness and anger, jealousy, who do you think is gonna be the king of the mountain in your life? But if you allow the Spirit to be number one, and you say, you know what, I'm gonna get rid of these negative mindsets and these compromising choices, and I'm not gonna be driven by the sinful nature, because Romans 8 says my sinful nature leads me to death, but if I'm led by the Spirit, I'm led to life, I'm gonna put this number one. I'm gonna feed my spirit. I'm gonna get in the Word of God. I'm gonna pray. I'm gonna make going to church a priority. I'm gonna be in a life group that encourages me. I'm gonna put my spirit number one so it can go all the way to the top and be the king of the mountain in my life and align me to the design, the purpose, and the nature of a loving, life-giving God. But you got to understand the order. So really quickly, let me give you a take-home, because I want to give you some practical things you need to do to try to shift the order, because you got to understand God's got great plans for you and God desires great things in your life. Listen to what it says in 2 Timothy. The expensive utensils are used for special occasions and the cheap ones are for everyday use. If you keep yourself pure, if you make your spirit the number one, you will be a special utensil for honorable use. Your life will be clean and you'll be ready for the master to use for every good work. Amen? So here's some things I want you to do. Number one, you need to start your day off right. You need to start your day off right. Every single day should be an opportunity to start with prayer. Reading the Bible. You know what? I don't really feel like it. But I want to sleep a little bit longer. Guess who's winning the battle in your soul? The Spirit has to override what you feel like and what you want. Everybody can get up 30 minutes earlier. You just got to choose it. Everybody can put the Bible on their app and listen to it on the drive to work. And pray. Everybody can. Everybody can start their day off right. It's just which one are you going to put in first? Listen to what it says in Psalms 91. Those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. If you make the Lord your refuge, if you make the Most High your shelter, no evil will conquer you. If you make God the number one, there is nothing that can conquer you. If you seek God, if you pursue God, there is nothing this world can throw at you that can knock you down. There is no storm that can sink the ships in your life. Amen? The second thing you need to understand is this. You got to reshape your priorities. You got to reshape what's important to you in life. Listen to what it says in Luke 12, 34. Wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will also be. Wherever you put as a priority in your life will follow. And too many times, we let our calendar depict our priorities instead of our priorities to depict our calendar. You need to schedule your life based with top priorities first, down to lower priorities. And the order goes as following: God first, family second, work is always third. And if you try to put your work more important than God and your family, you will suffer. And if you try to put your family before God, your family will suffer. You have to build your calendar around your priorities. And you need to understand something very clearly. We live temporary lives that are setting us up for an eternal life. And I can promise you, the order matters in eternity, not the other way around. God matters in eternity. Your family going with you to eternity matters. You don't take your job with you. Listen to what it says in Psalms 91. Teach us to realize the brevity of life so that we may grow in wisdom. It's short. Live it with what matters. Thirdly, you need to live life with purpose. You've got to live a life bigger than yourself. You can't live life serving just your needs. You've got to serve the needs of people. That doesn't just impact them here, but impacts them forever. You have to zero in on a purpose bigger than yourself. And you've got to populate heaven and make a difference in this world for God. Watch what it says in 1 Corinthians. Don't you realize that in a race, everyone runs, but only one person gets the prize. So run to win. All athletes are disciplined in their training. They do it to win a prize that will fade away. They do it for things in this world, money, things, statuses, titles. That's what they run for. Ah, but we do it for an eternal prize. So I run with purpose in every step. Let's populate heaven together. And you say, Pastor Mike, I don't even know where to start with purpose. You know where to start with purpose? You start with purpose. What do you mean? You just start serving anywhere. Literally, you stop making those compromising choices, you start making God number one, and you just start serving. Whether it's in the kids building, building up our world changes and our next leaders, whether it's a greeter telling everybody you matter and we're so glad you're here and we can't wait for you to experience God, whether it's cleaning on a weekday because we want to honor the people that come to our church, whether it's in the tech booth so that we can create an environment where people can encounter God, whether it's on the worship team, just serve anywhere, because I promise you, if you put God first and the kingdom of God first, he's going to start bringing those dreams he created with you out and opening doors for you to walk in, and your dreams will grow and your destiny will grow, and one day you'll stand in heaven and God will tell you to look around. He says, that person there, that's because of you. That person there, that's because of you. That person there, that's because of you. You were faithful in the little. Now I'm going to give you much. Let's party for eternity. That's what God wants to do in your life. You have something to offer. Get the order right. Give me 2 minutes and I'm done, because this is the most important thing I'm gonna do. Because there's people in this room who says, Pastor Mike, my order's not right. My spirit's not right. But my spirit's not right mainly because I don't have a relationship with Jesus. I've never committed my life to Jesus. I've never asked him to forgive me of my sins. Or maybe you have, but you've walked away. You've turned your back on him and you're not living a life as a Christian. You're not living your life as a believer. And right now, the first step to getting your order right is accepting Jesus into your life. It's your choice, but that choice can reflect eternity. And the Bible says very clearly that if you confess your sins with your mouth, your need for Jesus, and you believe in your heart that he forgives you, instantly you can be redeemed. Instantly you can be restored. Instantly your spirit can thrive. And so I want every single person in this room right now to pray this prayer. And if this is you, don't go one more moment settling for a life you were never intended to live. Everybody bow your heads, nobody looking around. And repeat after me. Dear Jesus, I have many mistakes in my life, but you still love me and you still pursue me. And today, I'm committing my life to you. I believe you died on the cross. I believe you rose from the grave. And I believe your blood washes away my sins. Come be a part of my life. I am forgiven. I am chosen. I matter.
Hi, family. We hope you enjoyed this week's message, and we pray that it spoke to your heart. If you made a decision today to follow Christ, or maybe you recommitted your life to Christ, we want to hear from you. Send us an email at connect@bloomhere.org so that we can send you the next steps in seeing you bloom into who you were created to be. You can also connect with us on our website, bloomhere.org. Or visit our Facebook page, Bloom Church, or Twitter and Instagram @ChurchBloom. We look forward to hearing from you. We love you, and we'll see you next week.